to the Spring 2013 Dworkin and Bernstein Management Lecture Series at Lakeland Community College. I appreciate your coming out on this rainy day, and I think you're really going to enjoy our speaker tonight, Patricia Babington from Rockwell Automation. Actually, Pat Babington and I have a long a relationship. She used to be my boss when I worked at Allen Bradley. I was a product manager, and she was the director of marketing at that time. And it was really great. It was the first time in my career that more than just that, most places where I worked, I was the only woman who was a professional. And this was the first time that I had actually worked for a woman executive. And that was really phenomenal to have that role model, because up to that, I'd never had that opportunity. So it was really wonderful. And I think Pat, just personally, I'm going to say something nice about you, sorry. I think she is one of the best strategic thinkers I have ever had the pleasure or honor of working with her for. Really amazing. And so in her position that she has today, she's really focusing on strategy. So let me talk a little bit about her, and then we can get her up here to talk. She's the director of the Architecture and Software Operations at Rockwell Automation. And she's responsible for business operational performance in areas of low-cost supplier business strategy, lean operations, and the adoption of common business practices across the whole operations. She joined Rockwell Automation in product marketing, like I was, but she was an applications engineer in the programmable controller business. She's held various roles, such as product manager, director of programmable controller business, director of business development and acquisitions. In 1995, she moved to the services business and was general manager of customer support and training. And she's been in her current position since 2004. Pat holds a bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from Cleveland State University, and she is a trained Six Sigma Black Belt. She lives in Brecksville with her husband and two sons. So would you please join me in welcoming Pat Babington, Director of Architecture and Software Operations. Sorry, we got stuck on the A. Let me say it again. Please join me in welcoming Pat Babington, Director of Architecture and Software Operations for Rockwell Automation.
It's a mouthful.
It's a mouthful.
Okay. Well, good evening, everyone, and once again, I thank you all for joining me. One of the wonderful aspects of my job is frequent airplane travel. And as you all know, for those of you who have been on airplanes, you get on the airplane and the flight attendant says, you know, welcome aboard, ladies and gentlemen. This is flight 123 bound for city XYZ. And then, you know, the flight attendant may go on to say about the weather in that city, or the flight time, or what gate we're going to be arriving at, and you're busy, you know, organizing yourself and settling in for your plane flight. Well, before security got tightened, and this is travel maybe 15 years ago, before security was very tight, they used to make another announcement. After all of that, they used to say, if this city that we're going to is not in your plans for today, now would be a good time to exit the aircraft. And eventually somebody would stand up and say, oh, I'm on the wrong plane. So if you're not here to listen to the Lakeland Community College Management Lecture Series, there's the door. Let me get started. I'm going to talk tonight in three areas. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about me. I think Chris did most of that. But I'll talk to you a little bit about how I got from each of those positions she mentioned and what I did along the way. I want to introduce you to Rockwell Automation and what we do here in Cleveland and what our corporation does around the world. And then I think what hopefully is most interesting to you is give you some of my insights in terms of leadership, management, and what's going on in the market. So I think that would be beneficial. So first of all, a little bit about me. As Chris mentioned, I graduated from the Fenn College of Engineering at Cleveland State with a Bachelor of Electrical Engineering. During that time, I spent 5 quarters at General Electric as a co-op student at Neela Park. And if any of you are familiar with GE, GE is the master of acronyms. So I worked in LRTSO in the MPCSL division on GRIP. Now, you'll wonder why that's important and why I bring that up, but actually, that moment that I worked in that group as a co-op set the tone for my entire career. LRTSO stands for Lighting, Research, and Technical Services Operation, and this is over at Neela Park. MPCSL was Manufacturing Process Computer Systems Laboratory, and GRIP was the project I was on, and that's General Research Image Processing. Well, little did I know what that was all about was automation. And at that time, GE was making their own custom control. And one of my jobs was to work with the engineers and the programmers to actually go into the lighting plants and work with them on installing this new equipment. Now, at this time, I was working in lighting, and if you think of a light bulb, the filament inside the light bulb is actually where all the electronics happen in the generation of light. And the way the filaments were selected, whether they were quality filaments, is you had an air table. So think of an air hockey table with air blowing all over it. And you had women, they were all women, with what I'll call coal miner hats, with the big light bulb on top, and these big glasses, and they would be sorting through these microscopic filaments that were going to go in the light bulb to see which were the good ones. Lovely job. So my job was to use the technology that GE was working on to determine, what of those filaments were good and which ones were bad. And so that was really all about automation, which is how do we make a process more reliable? How do we make it higher quality? How do we reduce the amount of work it takes to create better product? And so at that time, I didn't know that, but that, as I said, that was a critical moment in my career. I joined Alan Bradley after school. I was actually headed for Schenectady for GE, and I got a call from Alan Bradley, a recruiter at the time, and said, you know what, we were not on campus when we should have been, we messed up the schedule, so please come and visit us out in Highland Heights. And I said, well, I'm pretty well sold on GE, fantastic company, that's where I want to be. I've co-op with them, I've got a history, they've got some great programs. And they said, no, really, we're hiring lots of new people to start up this great programmable controller division. We've been in business in Cleveland for 5 years, and we're looking for lots of talent. So anyway, I made the trip out. I'm a West Sider, so I made the trip out to the East Side, and it was chaos. It was pretty crazy. And I thought, this place is nuts. People were sitting in the hallways. They were sitting on chairs without desks. And I thought, what a wild place. But there was an energy there and an excitement that I said, okay, I'm going for it. I never looked back. And someone asked me at dinner tonight, do you often wonder what it would have been like had you taken other positions? Every so often, yes, but generally it's been a wonderful ride. So my first job at Allen Bradley was an application engineer, and what I did is I went out into the field with customers, taking our brand new technology, and helped them understand how to make it work to run their plant. So some of the applications I was involved in were, simple programming and, on-off control or understanding how to connect two devices. And it was basically, pretty easy work. Rockwell Automation and Alan Bradley helped me really develop those skills by sending me to training, and then I had someone that worked with me to help me understand how to apply that technology, and then finally I was set off on my own. I then moved to, as an application engineer, I started to understand what customers did with our products, how the products worked, why our products were important, and from there I moved into product manager role, where I actually was responsible for a product that we would bring to market and help customers once again improve their automation. From that position, I was introduced to a brand new technology. It was sort of off the mainstream from where we were headed as a business, but they wanted someone to go off and evaluate a new technology. And I said, pretty well set in this product manager role. I felt important. I felt like I was kind of in a mainstream. And they said, we really need the help. So I went off. I think I lived in a conference room. It felt like a closet for about 3 months. And you know, doodled with this new technology and figured out how it worked. And 10 months later, I was responsible for the marketing of a brand new product that we brought into the business, and I was commuting back and forth to Vancouver, British Columbia. So from something I didn't want to do to technology that was not mainstream, suddenly, you know, I was in the spotlight. So you just can't tell how things are going to look as you know, as opportunities come up. From there, I moved into a strategic planning role, and that was to look at markets and opportunities and where we should be selling our product and new customers. I did a lot of work with kind of developing opportunities with partners. So, you know, once you realize you can't do it all, you go find friends. And so one of my roles was to go find technology suppliers that had similar technology and complementary, and to create contracts with them, joint marketing relationships, and share technology. And in many cases, we would license our technology so that they could put it in their product and connect to our control system. I then went back into the mainstream. So after kind of working on the outside of the main control system in various different jobs, I was then brought back into the programmable controller business to run the North American controls business. As I was doing that, my job was to look strategically at what our product offerings were and, you know, what new products, and that's when Chris and I connected up, what new products we needed and make sure that the product managers were creating new ideas. At that point, I realized that we had a serious shortcoming in our product suite, and that was in software. So I work with several people in our company, lawyers, finance people, some other individuals working on a business plan for acquisitions. So I got to see the legal side and the financial side of when you go buy a company, what are all the things you have to do? And you know, I learned very quickly all the legal ramifications and the licensing and the research that has to be done before you go off and buy a company. Well, after we went off and bought the company, I then moved into that business. We had spun that off as a separate software business. I joined up with that software business and then moved into a marketing role for that software product line. Well, I realize now a particular trait about myself is I liked uncharted territory. At first I was thrust into it, and then I realized, you know what, I actually feel comfortable kind of going into white space. So as I moved into the software business, I said, you know what, let me work on the services side of the business. It's kind of unexplored territory. It's a necessary evil. It's the support of the product. Nobody liked to do it. You know, it was being on the phone all day. And my challenge was to turn it into a profit and loss center. So what was a pure cost center, a cost to the business, by selling support contracts and selling phone support and selling service agreements, we turned that cost center into a profit center. After that, that profit center blossomed and it became a full business, a full P&L, and I ran the customer support and service business for the next few years. I'm currently in an operations role, and what I have done basically is captured all of those different experiences, top line experiences and bottom line experiences, and those have combined to make me you know, effective in a role of looking at how best and most efficiently to run our product operations. So that's a long story there. Okay. I want to talk to you a little bit about, you know, things I've done, places I've gone, people I've met, and especially I want to talk to the women in the audience, because I would be remiss as a woman in engineering in not talking about what it's like being in a technical field. And even if you are, you know, come from a business background, we have many business degree people in the technical field, and so this was not uncommon to have these experiences. I've traveled extensively. These are some of the areas I've been. I have not been to the Middle East. I was given an opportunity once, and my manager at the time said, you know what, I don't think it's a good idea, so we'll actually, probably we'll pass on that one. But I've been to a lot of different places. Given where I have been and things I have done, I have been whistled at, and this is said for the women in the audience, I've been whistled at, I've been in meetings, business meeting, I've been asked to give, you know, go get the coffee. I have been asked to defend my degree and make sure that, you know, nobody carries their degree around on, you know, certificate. It's like your passport or something. So I said, you know, I don't have my diploma with me, but I am an engineer. I've sat in many meetings waiting for the guy to show up because they didn't think that, you know, that I was the main speaker or the main person. I threw my Japanese host into a tizzy. Japanese have a very strong hierarchy in seating, and based on my title and my presence in a meeting, you know, where I was supposed to sit wasn't really in concert with where women were allowed to sit. So we went back and forth on where are they going to put me? You know, where's she going to sit? So, and so that was always exciting. Okay, some of the things I've done as an engineer. You know, a lot of fun things, a lot of hard things, a lot of crazy things. If any of you have been to Hershey, Pennsylvania and done the Hershey tour? Okay, so, you know, the great tour, you walk away with chocolates. I get to go in the back door and basically into the food processing plant where they're making the chocolate, and Alan Bradley Controls actually run a lot of that facility. And so you get to see, you know, a whole different perspective of the finished product. But if you know, you know, the Hershey brand, they pride themselves on you know, the Hershey chocolate taste. So it's not repeatable anywhere, and you would recognize it. And so you know, when they're making it, it has got to be perfect every time, all the time, and they want to make it you know, plentiful. I happened to be there once in one of my many visits during Halloween. And boy, that's the place to be at Halloween. You know, it's. I said, you know, I should have brought my trick or treat bag, but you know, they left. I left with many samples. I also got to travel to Alaska. Alyeska Pipeline was the company that was the creator of manufacturer or installer of the pipeline for the seven oil companies that formed the consortium to bring oil from Prudhoe Bay. And, you know, that was, you know, you fly to Anchorage and then you get on, you know, a bush pilot plane and you fly up to the North Slope. But we were looking at monitoring devices for, you know, the various stages of the pipeline. Another great opportunity was at General Foods plant in Indiana. And this was interesting. This was a variable frequency drive on a conveyor, and the product that the General Foods was making was lean strips. And it's an old product, but it's a soy bacon substitute. And it was, they were having problems coming out of the cooking area, coming down the conveyor, and when they were boxed and packaged. And so I was on the controls end. A counterpart of mine was working on the drive. And if any of you have seen the I Love Lucy episode in the factory with the candy making facility where the conveyor picks up and the candy's flying everywhere, that this topped this, you know. And so we were having, the bacon was flying all over the place. So there was a lot of yelling, there were a lot of unhappy customers, and you know, that was a learning experience where you don't try something new out on a live system, right? So, you know, we shut it down quickly. You know, we tested it in the program and made sure it worked, and then got things up and running. So, you know, it was a tough mistake. It was I wasn't welcome back in the plant again as an engineer, you know, because some of those things happen. So, so that was a learning and a good learning experience. Okay, enough about me. It gives you a kind of a sense of where I have been. Let me tell you a little bit about Rockwell. Okay, so Rockwell is a company that is actually the product of two other companies. The basis of Rockwell Automation is a company by the name of Alan Bradley that's headquartered in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Alan Bradley was founded in 1903 by two brothers and a friend. And they were a privately held company up until 1985. In 1985, they were purchased by Rockwell International. And Rockwell International was into the space program, the defense. They were in tools, electronics, telecommunications. Obviously, a very large global company bought this private company. In 1995, Rockwell International bought Reliance Electric, which is a homegrown Cleveland company. And those two basically have formed what is Rockwell Automation. Rockwell International has since spun off most of those other companies, and what is left is basically the world's largest company singly dedicated to industrial automation and information. We're about $6.3 billion in sales last year, 22,000 employees across the globe. 2,500 of them are actually in the greater Cleveland area, in our development centers, our sales, and our manufacturing facilities. Our Cleveland facility is located at Cedar and Lander Roads, right near Executive Caterers, Lander Haven. And we serve 80-plus regions of the world, and we're in all of those regions with sales, support, service, and some of our partners. Interesting note, 22% of our total sales are in emerging markets. So emerging markets being markets such as, China was, India, Thailand, Vietnam. And if you think about an emerging market, the first thing that they have to do is they have to really build an infrastructure to support growth. And the infrastructure is usually a power plant, probably an airport, maybe a transportation system. And the plants that are needed to help develop that, like concrete plants, manufacturing plants, we go in with our automation solutions and help allow those plants to deliver product to be able to build infrastructure. So, almost 25% of our sales came from those new markets. So the market is growing, the world is growing, automation is growing, and that's good for us. Okay, as I mentioned, we're not only in the products business, but we offer services as well as solutions. We will develop custom solutions for automation. And we are located in a variety of places around the world. We also have development centers that aren't mentioned here. And those development centers are in places like Dalian in China, Katowice, Poland. We have a couple places in the US and some places in Indonesia, as well as a large Singapore operation. Okay, what do we do? What's value proposition? Why does anyone want to buy Rockwell Automation equipment? Our products, our services, our solutions help optimize operations, the customer operations. So manufacturing is all about designing equipment, designing a product. You have to install the equipment to make the product, operate it, and then maintain it. And so our automation equipment helps in all of those four cycles. So we're able to work with the designers of a manufacturing plant. So let's say there's a brand new plant that's going to be built, and they put the equipment in to make diapers. Okay, so emerging countries, one of the first plants that goes in are home care. Toothpaste, diapers, because emerging economies want to buy those consumable products. So we would go into working with, Pampers, Kraft, General Foods, Procter & Gamble, and help them, put the equipment in, install the equipment, and provide support for them as they develop their facilities globally. We are everywhere. You're not going to see us because we're in cabinets. We're under machines. We're in locked doors. In some cases, we're underground. We're in towers, so you're not going to walk down the street or walk into a factory and necessarily, we're out in front. But if you looked at any of these behind the scenes, you're going to find Allen Bradley push buttons, Reliance drives, Allen Bradley programmable controllers, operator interfaces, plant networks, sensing devices, and a variety of products. Some of the more notable industries, we provide control for obviously controlling temperature. Anyone in the food processing industry, temperature is a critical attribute of developing a quality product, you know, tight temperature tolerances on developing product, you know, brewing, you know, any food production. And so our process control capability allows us to do temperature control. We also have capability for doing high speed control. And then I'm sure some of you have seen maybe on television the bottling lines. I mean, bottling lines are just zipping around. Those things go very fast. There's got to be automation to support the speed of that equipment to be able to bottle things that fast and you know, get them packaged and shipped. Ride control. You know, you see that entertainment up there. Think about, you know, when I say manufacturing, I know most people jump to the idea of a plant, right? A big building, you know, with a you know, a lot of heavy equipment, but an automated process could also be a ride. Think about a ride as a device, right? Sitting on a rail with you have to be able to start it. You have to be able to stop it. You have to have safety controls. You've got to be measuring its speed. You've got to be measuring, you know, the timing. And so a lot of our controls provide that capability for the vendors of equipment that go into amusement parks. Our products are also in very rugged environments. So we provide products that are on ships. You know, the U.S. Navy is one of our customers, so shipboard products, you're going to get a lot of salt, you're going to get a lot of corrosive materials on these products, and so they have to be able to withstand those types of temperatures and environments. So this is the fun part, because our stuff's behind the scenes, but here's some of the stuff that we actually help produce. I mentioned the chocolate bars, but, you know, most of you recognize all of these products, you know, cars. We're very heavy in the automotive industry, very heavy in the process industry around food, pharmaceuticals. We do a lot of assisting in FDA tracking for pharmaceuticals. That's a very important control application. Beer, wine, you see a lot of power generation, oil, mines and shipping, transportation. And so, you know, a lot of fun things that that ultimately are the result of working in coming out of an automated system. Okay, other fun things, once again, that you wouldn't think about manufacturing, but if anyone has seen Phantom of the Opera, there's a scene where the piano kind of takes flight. Well, the controls in the behind the Broadway plays used to be a bunch of guys and pulleys. But now it's all heavily automated, and you know, it's quite sophisticated in terms of a controller with automation in terms of the timing, the lines, the scenes, the control of the curtains, and things like objects flying around the stage. Obviously, if they flew around inappropriately, we could have a problem. So it's very important to have good, solid controls to support that. Okay, so as a company, we are also very, very proud of our position as an industry recognition as being very ethical. We've won this award in multiple years, and including this year, we were recognized as one of the world's most ethical companies. Very important sustainability. Many and probably most of our customers have sustainability initiatives. Recycling, green initiatives, you know, hazardous waste protection, and they want to make sure that we are able to support them in those initiatives. You know, recycling and hazardous waste controls for being able to run that process for you know, conserving power as well. Okay, so once again, a quick update on Rockwell. We offer a wide range of products, services, and solutions across many industries. We are a very good partner to our customers. We pride ourselves on being there when the customer needs us, staying ahead of industry trends and technology trends to meet their new needs, new businesses, where they establish new plants, and basically to have, you know, innovative solutions. Okay. I am going to switch over, so enough of PowerPoint, because I'm going to give you a little switch here. I'm going to switch over to some insights, management insights, that I want to share with you. And some of these are really tied to, first of all, I want to talk about what's going on in the market. And then tied to that, where do managers and management and business, how do they all come together and some guidance and maybe some direction that things that I have learned. What's happening today out in the business world? It is an interesting economy. And I say that because we have growth and we have restriction going on at the same time. I mentioned emerging markets. So we have new markets that are wanting to move into to viable economies, every day. What used to be, India, China, emerging economies, now it's Vietnam and it's Indonesia and areas that, areas in Africa. And little by little, these economies are trying to find their way into to more, moving out of the third world status. Automation and, industrial support is obviously a key part of our challenge. Some of the other, I said, at the same time as we've got great new opportunities, there's also more and more, not restrictions, but I will say things we've got to be really concerned about. And I'll talk about a couple of them, and that is safety applications. We are really seeing more and more companies being very concerned about industrial safety, about product safety, about personal safety within plants. So they are going to great precautions to make sure that they provide a safe environment for their employees, that their equipment is managed in a fail-safe mode. So if something were to go wrong, let's say a power fluctuation or a natural disaster, that the equipment would not get out of control in any way. So we basically have responded to that need by creating products in the safety space. And those are something as simple as a safety mat. So think of a large, maybe a compressor or, a welding machine. And the safety mat is in front of the welding machine. And if anyone were to inadvertently step on that mat when they shouldn't be there, the equipment would shut down. So rather than, expose an employee where they got too close to the machine, put themselves at risk or put the, equipment at risk, we would provide them that safety. Security, another really very important aspect of the world we live in today in terms of plant security. If you think about a power plant and the need for secure control around, whether it's a reactor, a power plant, or just power generation, disruption to the grid. Most of you here probably remember the disruption to the grid years ago, back in August, and it shut down the East Coast. Well, I mean, you want to be able to prevent those types of events happening. So you want to have a secure system, you want to have a fail-safe system, and backup. And so, a lot of those challenges and opportunities are where control fit in the name. Some of the other things, developing safe product. So when we put a product in a plant, our product is basically a industrialized computer. It's the brains of how things get decided, the logic that gets decided for what happens in a plant. So, and I'll use a simple example of a car wash. We have many applications that the car washes are run by a programmable controller. And you think about, you pull up to the car wash and they guide your wheel into that rail, and there's a switch there. And that switch triggers logic in a controller to say, okay, start moving that conveyor forward, drag the car with you, right? Get that tire moving. And then another switch, when you go down that path of the rail, the next switch would say, okay, it's time to load the soap on. So then the logic in the controller would say, load the soap on, how much soap am I giving, is it the right volume, is it the right force that it's being laid on, and then, you know, you can imagine what goes on, the timing of, you know, if the soap was put on at the same time, you know, the wipers, you could create a mess. I mean, you could have, if you have everything going on at once, and the drying, so you get soap dried on your car, you know, and then later on, you know, the water is applied and you go out and your car looks beautiful, right? So it really is important that things happen in a very logical progression of timing. And so that's the type of thing that we would get involved with. Okay, some of the other challenges that we face that are out in the market today, supply chain interruptions. And so think about Rockwell as a vendor. We provide product to customers. Well, we have to buy product from our vendors. And the products we buy are circuit boards, they're electronic components, they may be connectors or cables, and we buy them globally. So it used to be we had a lot of local sourcing and we bought material locally, but as the markets expanded, we were buying from all over the world. Well, think about what happened, the Japan tsunami, the Thailand floods. Well, we had, you know, any plants that were in those locations, any companies that were running small businesses that were creating or you know, bringing parts to the market, basically they were taken offline. And so, you know, they can't deliver parts to us. Those parts go in our critical products. We can't deliver products to customers. So supply chain disruptions are a big factor being a global purchaser of products. And so some of the things that we have to put in place in terms of alternate vendors and the contingency plans make planning very interesting. One of the toughest supply chain disruptions that we had was actually the economic recession recovery. It wasn't during the recession, it was during the recovery. So the recession, you know, everybody shut down, people stopped making things, people stopped buying, everything kind of went dormant. But the recession, the recovery was a V recovery. I mean, the economists talk about the W recoveries and the U recoveries, but it was a V. It went down like a rock and it just skyrocketed back up. And so that recovery said, okay, we need to, you know, we were making 10 because of a very slow market, we now need to make 1,000 product. And we need all the components to make 1,000 products, and all you vendors, you better give us those components. Well, they stopped making components too. And so one of the biggest disruptions was scrambling to try to find more and new vendors to provide components so we could get back up online and, as I said, make those 1,000 products versus the 10. Regulatory and compliance is another new aspect of the market, and that's basically tying into issues around restriction of different substances, you know, removing lead from products, making sure that they are not hazardous material, and activities like that. Okay, so let's get on to some insights and recommendations about, you know, what you're going to see. So you get out into the business world, more than likely, and I said if you go to a large company, absolutely for sure, you're going to be living in a matrix environment. You will not have one boss. You might have two bosses. You may have three. High likelihood of that not all the bosses will be in the same city as you. And so this puts a real challenge on your ability to perform for your manager, to be able to, for them to understand what it is you're doing. And so I can't stress enough good communication skills, good writing skills, good communication, to be able to articulate a point you know, in a very compressed environment. I mean, so you're not going to be able to talk on the phone for hours and hours, so quick emails, text, to get your point across about maybe, you know, things that your manager needs to support you on. I would say kind of what I'll call the anti-matrix is, as a manager, you are probably going to have to get things done from people that you don't manage. And so this is just the reverse challenge, which is you need to get something done, and there's a lot of people out there that have to deliver for you, but you don't manage. So I give a lot of career advice to some of my early career folks that I work with, and that is to really develop the power of you. And by the power of you, I mean to develop influence and leadership skills and basically focus on, you know, your thought leadership and how you encourage people to work with you and accomplish things for common goals without using the "I'm the boss" or "my boss told you to do this" or, you know, "I have a great title." So you find that some of the most influential people in companies don't have any title. They're just this person that shows up, and it's amazing how much they get done or how much they're able to convince people to get things done. The other change in the market is positions that exist right now may not exist in 5 years. Positions that exist right now didn't exist 5 years ago. And I'll just use the C example. Traditionally, companies are run by CEOs. You have a CEO, you have a chief financial officer, and you might have a chief operating officer. Then, you know, we saw the chief technical officer. Right now, we're moving into chief compliance officers, chief safety officers, chief process officers. Those were not even on the radar years ago. You know, the other area is what was, you know, looks like a bad job or, you know, not a fun activity or an area that, you know, seems like a side activity in a business might be the primo business in a couple years because that technology or that business area or that market need took off. So don't shun kind of any opportunity that said doesn't look exciting because you can't, you really don't know and it's hard to predict what's going to be, you know, hot. Okay, so I want to talk to you about some of the marketing and business messages that you probably hear whether it's in the classroom or just from your own personal experience, and what's some of the contradictory messages you might be getting in my interpretation. So you'll hear this a lot. Be global, okay? That's the advice, you know, think globally, be global. But you better understand your customers in their regional markets. Stay the course, focused. You know, don't lose focus, prioritize, but be flexible, okay? So be flexible to change. Take a lot of risks, but you better deliver what you committed. Think strategic, you know, have great ideas, but have a bias for action. Make decisions quickly, be decisive, but you better have all the facts collected first. So those sound like contradictions in terms of management direction, and they are to some extent. So let me give you some insight in terms of, you know, how to translate those. So first of all, global, be global. One size does not fit all. So as global as you'd like to be, and as much as you'd like to create one product, and you ship it out the door, and it fits perfectly for everyone, that's not reality. You have local restrictions in regions. You have import-export laws. You've got technology restrictions. You've got market restrictions. So you really have to pick and choose what you can globalize and what you have to regionalize. And I'll use an example of translating documents. You know, we all buy commercial products, and you get the fold-out 9,000 squares, and it folds out to, you know, it's size 2 font, and it's in 50 languages, and it tells you how to open your toothpaste. And you think, well, that's crazy, right? Well, think of a very complex control system that has to do all those languages with a very difficult set of instructions. So what we've moved to is something called Simple English. Simple English is you pick the most base, simple English terms to describe an activity, and it makes it much easier to translate and more cost effective. Okay, stay the course, but be flexible. My recommendation is don't wait for something to happen, make it happen. So don't wait for change or adapt to it or you know, drive it, shape it. So go after it and be more aggressive than, as I said, waiting. The reason that you lose focus and the reason that you're starting to prioritize is because if you're reacting, you're probably scrambling. And so you really lost control of your destiny by reacting to change rather than getting ahead of the game. Take risks. Take risks, but deliver what you need to, what you committed to. And so in that area, I would say you have to be focused on making sure that you deliver what you committed to from a perspective of, you know, As a public company, we have to deliver earnings per share. We give guidance to the market every quarter, and we ask people to say, this is what our performance is going to be. We also want to grow the business and buy new companies and get excited about things. And basically, you know, that's very difficult to do. We want to take a lot of risks, but we want to deliver on our earnings. So that's a challenge that we have to meet. Okay, so some recommendations as I wrap up here. Learn to recognize and embrace opportunities. So focus on recognizing them and then embracing them. Thomas Edison quote that I really love that says that opportunity is missed by most people because it comes dressed in overalls and looks like work. And as I said, there's a lot of things that look dull and boring, and you thought, you know, I don't want to do that, but it may be the best opportunity that will come by. Seek out white space. Look for those opportunities that haven't been capitalized on or pursued, and then make your opportunity happen. Admit your mistakes. You will make them, but move on. If you've ever had to make a decision, you have made mistakes. And so those people who have never made mistakes haven't made decisions. And you can let that happen to you. You can let people around you decide what to do, and you can be mistake-free, but that's not a business success factor. The other area I would say is learn to love what you do. Work with respect the people that you work with, and really have fun. So I thank all of you for being with me tonight. I thank you for staying on the plane with me, and I hope I was able to give you some insight about what's kind of going on in the market. Thank you. I guess we open for questions. You know, it's interesting. I just attended a session in Columbus sponsored by Battelle Institute and STEM, which is science and technology. And more universities are doing industry partnerships. Field trips are coming back. You know, they want to do some of the college research in manufacturing or in the industry you're in. And so there is definitely a move to bring students back into the real world and to give them firsthand exposure to, you know, what are the issues that they're facing, to learn right up front what they're going to be dealing with, to develop their knowledge and skill set, but also maybe to give them a sense of this isn't the best fit. And so I do see it coming back. As an engineer, when I look at hiring, if there's a co-op student and a non-co-op student, I will always take the co-op student, always. That co-op student, if they're still in the field, it says, well, they know what they're getting into because they've had an opportunity to see what happens. They've learned to mature. They kind of understand the dynamics of a business environment. And, you know, I cannot speak highly enough for internships, co-ops, working in your field, whatever way you can. Well, that is a tough question because my husband is also an engineer, and for the first 7 years of marriage, we did not have children. So we traveled extensively, as you saw. We met up in various cities, and then we decided to start a family. So for the first few years, we had a nanny. I had someone come into the house to watch the children. And then my husband decided to start his own business, and he stayed home. So I have a stay-at-home husband. So I think I may be unique because I didn't have to go through, I know, many of the struggles that women do today, or men, by having both partners working and raising a family. So to be honest, I have more of a traditional model because my husband stayed home to watch the boys. And so from that perspective, with my travel and the amount of work, outside sort of the regular work environment and the amount of late night phone calls, it would really have been very difficult to have two working partners. So the way I balanced it is my husband pulled it off for me. Well, you know what? There's no developer, there's no marketer, there's no business person who can do it all themselves. And you know, I mean, I think that's a well-known, you know, philosophy. And I think from that perspective, especially with a highly dispersed workforce, developments, I'll sort of say, chunked up into various areas around the world, you're only doing maybe a part of a larger activity. So you can't do the whole thing anyway. And so teamwork, communication skills, being able to work well with people, and we really focus on a lot of attention on understanding different cultures, understanding, you know, different gender behaviors, because people come to work differently. They have different personal experiences home. You know, it goes back to the previous question. They have personal situation, and everybody, you bring that to work. And so you've got to be able to, because you have to work so closely in a team, you've got to be able to understand that the dynamics are playing there and be open to where people are when they start working with you. So teamwork is not even, it's not a question, it's not an option, it's a given. And those who find themselves, you know, maybe socially awkward in the sense of, you know, don't like to ask questions, you know, people who don't like to ask for help, or think they know everything, really find themselves boxed in a, you know, boxed up pretty quickly, because they really can't get done what they need to get done. I'll say two. One was, We were working with a large computer company, and we were working on a relationship between the two of us, and jointly we wanted to go out and sell this combined product. Well, they were coming from a computer background, we were coming from a control background, and when our customers saw us together, they said, well, this is kind of an odd marriage. And the reason they thought that, because the traditional factory was divided up by information technology and control, and it was never the twain shall meet. And so here are two companies coming together, trying to bring all those people together, and they didn't want to come together. And so we were pushing a strategy of integrated automation and information. So here's all your control information. We want to send it up to the CEO. We want to make sure that the IT networks were linked, and the basic companies didn't want to work together. The second challenge was selling service contracts. So here's a company, a historical company based on hardware, based on selling things, and we were trying to sell service, which is a service, which is, you know, help, right? It didn't come in a box. You couldn't feel it, you couldn't touch it, and the engineers were, well, I bought the product, so everything else should be free. So you should train me for free, you should, you know, support me 7/24 for free, you should come out and visit me for free, and those things are expensive. And so trying to change the strategic model that we had set, and it's part of our culture, to change the model from a model of free to fee was no small task. So those were definite strategic changes to the company that were difficult. That's a good question. In fact, I'll be thinking about that later. Oh, let's say 8, retired. So I have a very wonderful career at Rockwell, and you know, probably in about 8 or 9 years, I'm going to be wrapping things up and moving on to not working, but something different than automation. So right now, I am working on kind of combining all the different activities I've had over my varied career positions, and I'm having a lot of fun. And actually, somebody asked me at dinner. They said, "Well, you know, how did you move ahead to each of those positions? What did you think you would be doing when you started your career? What do you think you'd be doing now?" And I said, you know what, I never thought about it. I really kind of went with the flow. And by that, I don't mean I sat back and let things happen to me. I just, you know, I luckily was open-minded enough to just, hey, that looks neat. Or somebody would recommend to say, you'd be good at this. And then after that cadence of, you know, try this, then it started to become part of the way I looked at things, which is, oh, you know, I would like to try that. And in fact, here's a business case, and I think here's what we should do. So I started to develop that expertise and that talent for finding new opportunities, selling and promoting them, and getting myself involved with them. But I didn't plan that. And even, you know, early in my career, I didn't think, well, I want this job or I want that job. It's just, this is neat what I'm doing. And then something else neater came along. And so that was my strategy. So I have an engineering degree, right? We didn't have to talk. We didn't have to write. and that's, you know, that's probably one of the toughest parts about an engineering curriculum, is you really don't get as much of the liberal arts as you probably should. And so PowerPoint is wonderful for engineers because we don't have to use punctuation and we don't have to use capitals skip right to the point, right? And so that was very difficult. So, you know, to really focus on, well, you know what I mean. You know, I mean, in engineering, you know, you kind of lay out a diagram, and you can look at the diagram, and sometimes it speaks for itself. But when you're communicating, well, what do we do next, or what's the game plan, you really have to be very clear and articulate, what are we going to do, how are we going to do it, who's going to do it. And you have to think logically and then be able to articulate that logic. And so I would say that was a challenge early on, especially when you're in a new technology and you're trying to explain it to someone who maybe is not in the technology. And if you don't have the communication skills, you're doing one of these. You know, well, that's what I just said. Well, I just told you that, right? And they're hearing something else. So communication skills, writing skills, even though we text, and we email and we shortcut with PowerPoint, writing skills are still very, very important. In fact, as I write more business cases, and it's fun for me because I happen to sit in an area where I have three lawyers that sit around me, and they're big on writing, okay? Because, I mean, that's what they do for a living, right? They write up all these analysis of opportunities and in cases, and they are very specific about what they mean and how they say it. And in fact, if you've ever been in any legal activity or been in court, you know, you're usually counseled to say, you know, just say what you mean. Don't elaborate, don't go other places. And that's communication skills. And when you're communicating technical, information, you need to be real clear about that. And you just can't assume they're gonna come along with you. So communication skills, presentation skills, writing skills are as important today as they were when I started. And I said that's something that I had good mentors. I watched what people did who were successful, and that the fact that they were able to articulate their thoughts. And it was a learning process. Oh, very heavy. If you look at any automotive plant globally, the paint stations, the assembly, car manufacturing process strategy, the equipment that goes into an automotive plant is run by Allen Bradley Rockwell Controls. The drives, conveying the overhead conveyor systems that, you know, bring the chassis. You know, I would say our history is based in automotive. So, you go into any automotive plant, you'll see a wealth of motor control centers, drives, push buttons, programmable controllers out the wazoo. Just as I said, really good and strong application for us.